close your eyes. Now imagine a dinosaur walking down the street of your neighborhood. The dinosaur towers above you, its enormous head peeking over the roof of your house. A sudden shadow causes you to look up at a flock of flying pterosaurs, blocking out the sun and casting long shadows down your street. In the distance, a mighty roar seems to vibrate the air. You are living in a world of dinosaurs. Dinosaurs no longer walk the earth, but their fossils buried underground continue to give us a fascinating glimpse of their world. In today's art and movies, we can see seemingly real-life dinosaurs, and yet, all we have left of them are bones. How do paleontologists take scattered, incomplete fossil remains found in the ground and reassemble them into complete skeletons? When new species of dinosaurs are discovered, paleontologists often have an incomplete skeleton. Perhaps they find just a skull, a few vertebrae, and a leg bone. Scientists have to put together what they have and fill in the holes of what is missing. How do they figure out which bones are missing? One of the most common techniques is to compare dinosaur skeletons with modern animal skeletons. For example, when the T-Rex was first discovered, paleontologists noticed the bones had some similarities to the skeleton of a chicken, with an S-shaped spine, three forward-pointing toes, and large back legs. Using the placement of the bones in the chicken skeleton for reference, they pieced together the bones they had, and then filled in the gaps with bones they believed would fit. We now have a much larger database of fossils on record, as more and more new species continue to be found. This allows paleontologists to compare newly discovered dinosaur fossils to other dinosaur fossils on record, as well as living animals, when an incomplete skeleton is found. Sometimes, a particular species' skeleton can be completed using multiple fossils of the same dinosaur found in different locations. Like puzzles, fossils are often missing pieces, which is why it is so important to find more than one fossil of a species. Paleontologists also team up with geologists, biologists, engineers, and computer experts to learn even more about these dinosaurs. Geologists look at the earth surrounding the fossils. Did the animal live in a swampy environment by an ancient river? Or did it live in a desert with very little vegetation? Biologists study the fossils looking for scratches or damage that could tell them how the dinosaur might have died. Engineers recreate the skeleton in a 3D model to see how the dinosaur might have moved. Computer experts create computer models to see what they might have looked like and what their capabilities might have been. For example, looking at a recreation of a T-Rex, scientists can determine how fast it would have been able to run, based on the muscle and bone structure. These methods also give us a pretty good idea of what dinosaurs might have looked like. Let's take a look at some dinosaurs and what we know about them from the research gathered by these scientists. This is a Megalosaurus, a fossilized jawbone discovered in 1824 by William Buckland. Was the first fossil that was correctly identified as belonging to a dinosaur, although the term dinosaur wouldn't be used until years later. A smaller version of the T-Rex, Megalosaurus had a square-shaped head and generally grew to about 7 meters or 22 feet long. This species is a type of theropod, a dinosaur that stands on two legs and has short arms and a long tail. In the late 1900s, there was a rush to discover the world's largest dinosaur. Exciting fossil discoveries thought to be massively large dinosaurs led to names like Supersaurus and Ultrasaurus. However, initial estimates were often incorrect, and these supersized dinosaurs were frequently downsized once the incomplete skeletons were taken back to the lab. What we do know is that all of the world's biggest dinosaurs belong to a group of four-legged herbivores called sauropods. This family of dinosaurs is easily recognizable by their large bodies and small heads, not to mention their long necks and tails. The most famous sauropod is the well-known Brachiosaurus, whose name translates to arm lizard. This references the fact that its front legs were longer than its rear legs. Discovered in 1903, scientists assume that Brachiosaurus used its long neck to browse the vegetation of high trees and that they traveled in family packs. One sauropod currently holds the distinction of being considered the largest dinosaur of all time. This is the massive Argentinosaurus, named for its discovery in Argentina. Only a small portion of this skeleton has been found, but using reconstruction methods, paleontologists estimate that this behemoth stretched about 30 to 40 meters from head to tail. That's anywhere from 100 to 130 feet long. From ground to head, it stood 20 meters, or about 65 feet tall. Some other sauropods are believed to have been larger than Argentinosaurus, but there is not enough evidence yet to support this. So, Argentinosaurus remains the record holder for the time being. While dinosaurs roamed the Earth, their cousins, the pterosaurs, dominated the skies. The word pterosaur means winged lizard, and while they are related to dinosaurs, they are not actually dinosaurs themselves. Belonging to this group of flying reptiles is the fan favorite, Pterodactylus, the first pterosaur to be discovered. The Italian scientist who discovered it thought he had found a new marine animal. Soon, however, paleontologists realized they had unearthed an entirely new group of animals. One of the most exciting discoveries in this group was the massive Quetzalcoatlus. This pterosaur boasted a wingspan of nearly 40 feet and may have weighed 500 pounds or more. Because of its immense size, scientists are not sure if this particular reptile was capable of flight, or it spent its life on the ground. In the early 1800s, Mary Anning and her brother Joseph lived on the coast of England, a place rich with fossils. Their father taught them how to locate and excavate the fossils, which they sold to help provide for their family. Mary and Joseph discovered the intact skeleton of a marine reptile, similar in shape to a modern dolphin. It was named Ichthyosaur, which translates to fish lizard. This sharp-toothed animal was generally around 10 feet long and likely propelled itself with a long fish-like tail. This skeleton was not the only discovery that Mary would make. In 1823, she came across the skeleton of a plesiosaur, the first time this particular reptile had been found. The fossil of this long-necked swimming reptile was thought to be a fake at first, but was soon confirmed by noted paleontologists. Sadly, Mary's discoveries were often not credited to her at the time because she was a woman. Today, however, you can see Mary's plesiosaur hanging in the Natural History Museum in London. Mary would go on to find many more fossils in the cliffs near her home, proving that the massive reptiles were not limited to the land or air, but ruled the sea as well. Fossil discoveries give us a fascinating glimpse into the past, its inhabitants, and their lives. Often we only have a few key pieces of a particular skeleton, and the rest of the picture is left to science, informed guesses, and imagination. Every day, paleontologists are discovering and uncovering more pieces of this endless puzzle.